read the gospel selection for today, I do want to make sure that all in the community are aware that we lost another member this last week. Janet Lippe passed away last Sunday. Many of you were at the visitation yesterday, and thank you for coming out to support her family. Janet was a dear, loving, kind, and generous soul, and will be missed by all of us. So we do offer our thanks to God at this time when we gather as community, that we shared this life with one so sweet and kind. Remember Janet and her family. And now from the Gospel of Luke, we pick up right where we left off last Sunday. You'll remember last Sunday, the scripture began saying that Jesus returned to his hometown of Nazareth and went to the synagogue, as was his custom. He was a regular worshiper. He joined with the other men of the community to listen to scripture and to consider what it might mean for living in this world. And they were with him, and they handed him the scroll, passing over the baton of teaching to the returned hometown boy. And it was the scroll of Isaiah, and he found the place where it begins, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor." And then he began his sermon, and we pick up at verse 21. "Then he began to say to them, 'Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.' And everyone was speaking well of him, and were amazed at the gracious words that flowed from his mouth. They said, 'Is not this Joseph's son?' And he said to them, 'Doubtless you will quote me this proverb, Doctor, cure yourself. And you will say, Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you were doing in Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine throughout our land. And yet Elijah was sent to none of them, only to a widow of Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman, who was a Syrian. And when they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up and they drove him out of the town, and they led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl Jesus off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way." May God add a blessing to the reading of the gospel word. A vacation afternoon with ample time to kill, a multiplex theater with several PG sci-fi flicks on the marquee, escaping an unusually muggy July day in Nebraska with 3 children in tow, we seized the bargain matinee prices and chose an unconventional lunch of raisinettes and buttered popcorn and juice boxes. It's a balanced meal if you really think about it. And 6 hours later, emerging from the dark air-conditioned theater, we blinked against a bright Omaha sky. The planet, thankfully, was still in one piece, and no hostile aliens were hovering over Omaha today. We had just watched, back to back, Captain Stephen Hiller, played by Will Smith, in Independence Day, and Captain James T. Kirk, played by William Shatner in Star Trek Generations, and Captain Jean-Luc Picard, played by Patrick Stewart, in First Contact. Each of these stellar men defeating aliens, and therein saving us all from certain destruction. And along the way, we had watched humankind pull together, despite all of our differences, striving for the common good of humanity in the desperate moment. Walking back to our car, 8-year-old Matthew spoke up thoughtfully, "People like each other better when they're fighting aliens." Recently, a ministry colleague said something similar, commenting on the decline in church attendance across our culture, the loss of membership in all kinds of voluntary associations which once thrived, the lack of citizen engagement and efforts to improve our community, he half-jokingly said, "What we really need is a great war. Humans pull together, you know, despite our differences, when we can identify a common threat." Well, yes, we do. The good people of Nazareth pulled together quickly. Upon identifying a common threat, they decided the best thing to do was to join forces and throw the threat off a cliff. It's a startling change from their response to Nazareth's favorite son at the beginning of their worship time together, when Jesus first read those lines from Isaiah promising release and redemption and healing for all those who have been cast off by this world. The men of the synagogue were well pleased by those words. "Isn't this Joseph and Mary's kid? My goodness, he's so well spoken, and we keep hearing reports from everybody about the miracles he's doing throughout the region." What did Jesus say in that sermon that so dramatically changed their feelings towards him? His neighbors were still on board with his message when he proclaimed, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." They like that. Today. No more waiting. Today. God will be reaching out and blessing those who have been marginalized and left behind and taken for granted by people. But then the hometown boy takes it further as he realizes his neighbors are assuming that they are the cast-offs that Isaiah describes. Jesus goes out of his way to bring up stories about people God blessed whom his hometown synagogue would have named as the aliens, foreigners, strangers, enemies. Jesus reminds them God blesses marginalized people as God chooses, and they may not be in the mix. Jesus continues his proclamation by alluding to two famous prophets, Elijah and Elisha. With so many stories to choose from, he picks two about prophetic ministry to aliens. He doesn't talk about what God did in the past for the chosen people. He talks instead about how God walked past the people inside the covenant and blessed people who were outside of it. Jesus knows his hometown crowd is already jealous about the work he has been doing in Capernaum, territory they consider almost heathen, and now he infers that his continuing ministry is to be directed away from his hometown and toward them, the capital T, them, the them that are not us. The good folk of Nazareth have waited and waited for their day to come. They've had their share of disappointments and false starts. The signs seem to be pointing to a change in their fortunes, and they lean in at worship for good news. So when Jesus begins his sermon with the assurance, "Today is the day of the Lord's favor," well, they're ready for it. And then he turns down this unexpected homiletical alley filled with aliens and enemies. How can you tell us the promise is to be fulfilled today in our sight and then suggest it isn't being fulfilled just for us? How dare you suggest that what we have been waiting for is going to be given to them? In the hearts of these faithful worshipers who moments ago were in a fine mood and enjoying a good service, anyone fully realizes what they're doing. They're pushing and jostling one another all the way to the edge of town and the cliff. They're angry. They are so angry. Now what? If this is Jesus' view of them, what are they supposed to do next? One thing's for sure, they're not inviting him back to preach again in their synagogue. What started out so well as he rolled up the scroll in the synagogue ends with Jesus turning away from the cliff's edge and simply walking through the crowd. He doesn't blast them with some magic glowing finger or resist them even. He simply walks right through them and leaves them behind, shaking the dust from his own sandals. His ministry lies elsewhere in more fertile ground. Imagine how popular Jesus would have been in Nazareth if he had just told them what they wanted to hear. He could have banded them together enthusiastically by naming the people in Capernaum as their enemies maybe, or the alien invaders from Rome, the real threat, a threat which could unite the people of Capernaum and Nazareth and all of Galilee against them. People like each other better when they're fighting the aliens. But this common enemy ploy, which could bring them a great war, and maybe even vault synagogue attendance to all-time highs, isn't what Jesus chooses. There's no shortage of potential aliens for Jesus to identify as the real and present threat. But striving for the common good of human flourishing, Jesus brings a different message to the world than what his neighbors expect. You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I say love your enemies and pray for the ones who are persecuting you. You've heard an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. I say forgive one another as I forgive you. Jesus has a much more nuanced understanding of aliens. Different doesn't mean enemy, and even enemy doesn't mean hate. As Jesus teaches throughout the Galilean hillsides, he keeps returning to their own scriptures. The God of Abraham is concerned about all the families of the earth. God's favor is not limited to one person or one nation. They are to be a light on a hill which draws all the nations to God's message of reconciliation. God gives the blessings of the sun and the rain, compassion and care to all people on the earth. Those who draw close to Jesus and try to walk in his way find the blessings of a new way of being in the world. Grace and mercy bring abundance. Abundance that conquers the darkness of oppression, captivity, violence, and fear. And as it was for God's servants of the past, a special relationship with the God of love leads to an active life focused on extending the reach of God's reign of justice and peace until all are included in the blessing. It was true in the time of the prophets, it was true in the time of Jesus, and it's still true today. What did my 8-year-old son observe in his experiences of human behavior and his consumption of way too much sci-fi television and movies offered up from his parents? What did he see that led him to believe that we are at our best when we are fighting a common enemy? He had already seen for himself how quickly we're willing to band together to drive off a perceived threat, even if that threat is our neighbor. I've come to a different conclusion about people and their potential to band together. I believe people like each other best when they are welcoming aliens, not fighting them. When they are opening their homes and their hearts to them, providing water in the desert, giving food to the hungry, shelter to the homeless, clothing to the naked. I've seen up close in this neighborhood and across this nation and in other countries where I have traveled, we like each other better when we stop naming God's other children as aliens and strangers, and instead see what Jesus always saw, the
reflection of the divine shining forth from their faces. And despite all the sci-fi I have consumed in my lifetime, I do not live in fear of a menacing threat named Alien, which is going to appear someday in a Midwestern sky or flood over our borders, either south or north. But I do recognize a clear and present danger, which already threatens human flourishing. It's the fearful resentment which lurks in our hearts when we sense that a them is going to get something we believe belongs to us. That resentment is the source of nameless rage, and it is fertile soil for sin. To free us from the oppression of that darkness which lurks within, Jesus chose the scroll of Isaiah and read to his friends and neighbors, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because God has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Let's not be oppressed by the blindness of captivity to resentment. Let's claim our freedom.